You are listening now to A Word of Faith with Bishop Macedo.
Thanks be to God. May God bless you, my dear listener, and may the Holy Spirit may you understand what is His will, so that you can hear His voice, His words, so that you can know what else to do with your life, so that you can know and make the best choice that there is for your life. Because when you hear the Word of God and you practice and you obey it and you follow this Word, so then you are hearing and following the Lord Jesus Christ. So we are here to help you understand what God wants from you. We are here as the doors that are open for the Holy Spirit to reach you that are afflicted, that are facing difficulties, you that find yourself with fear, having an incurable disease in your body. We are going to help you, and by faith you shall be blessed. In a few minutes, we are going to be back with you, with God's Word. Very well. We have been speaking for the last few days about the sower and the seeds. The sower is the Lord Jesus, and the seed is the Word of the Lord Jesus. So, Jesus said that the sower went to sow, some seed fell by the wayside, and the birds came and devoured them, devoured the Word, and that Word did not bear fruit. Then Jesus said that another seed fell on stony places among the rocks. And what took place, since there was not enough ground, not enough earth, so that seed immediately sprang up, and because there was no depth, it died. Then the third part of the seed fell among the thorns, and it sprang up. It sprang up, but the thorns choked this seed, and it could no longer bear fruit and died. And the last seeds fell on good soil. And see what Jesus says here. But others fell on good ground and yielded a crop, some 100-fold, some 60, and some 30. And the Lord Jesus says that the one that was sowed on good ground is the one who hears the Word and understands it, and who indeed bears fruit and produce some 100-fold, some 60, and some 30. So, my dear listener, The Lord Jesus, He shows for all humankind that uses their intelligence, that uses their capacity to think, saying that the Word, His Word, God's Word, is the seed that produces good fruits. But now, but the Word of God alone is not enough. The Word alone is not enough. The Word needs the seed, needs the land, needs the ground. It must be sowed on a good ground. And the good ground is those kind of people that hears the Word and understands, meaning practice. Jesus said to the Jews, He told them, to the Jews that were hypocrites and Pharisees, "You all do not believe in me because you are not my sheep. You don't belong to my flock." And He said more, "My sheep hear my voice. My sheep hear my voice. And I know them, and they follow me." Look at that. Look how interesting, my dear listener. God, He wants to sow the good seed in the human being. How can I believe in this God? Many people ask this question, thinking like this. How can I believe in God if I have an incurable disease in my body? How can I believe in God if my son was killed in a car accident? How can I believe in God if a disaster took place in my family? People actually do not think. And because they are using their emotion in that moment, so they allow their feelings to take over. And they don't consider the fact, for example, a person, got drunk, and when driving a car under the influence and hit and killed somebody as they drove and they died, so they do not take in consideration that they made choices. They made the choices of the fruits of the seed of came inside of their heart. So they obeyed the impulse of their desire, the desires of their heart. And obviously, the consequences take place. Others, they get married in any way, anyhow. The first person that they see and is handsome or that or beautiful, and they get married, and now they discover it's not the right person, and now they begin to have problems in their life. And then come the heartbreaks of life. So, my dear listener, life depends on what we are sowing, on what we are sowing. And God Himself, He sowed His Word. His Word is being sowed all over the world. All over the world. But who wants to hear His voice? Who wants to receive of it? Who actually wants to practice His Word? Who wants to submit to it? Who is humble to obey this word? Few are the ones. That is why the sower, he went to sow, and only a quarter of it heard and obeyed. The other three-fourths, simply, they ignored the word. So, my dear listener, this is how life is. This is how life is. The Bible says that Isaac, the son of Abraham, he sowed in a land that was not his. Isaac, he sowed in a foreign land. And because God was with him, because he was obedient to God's word, so then he reaped 100 for 1. So each seed he was able to reap 100 over 1. So Jesus says that the one that was sowed on the good ground, each seed was multiplied into 100 or into 60 or into 30. And we can see a very, very important lesson for you to understand. For you to understand that there is not a great injustice than equality. Equality is the worst injustice that there can be. And you can see that some seeds produced 100, another seed produced 60, and another seed produced 30. So whose fault is it? Is it the seed or the ground? Whose fault is it? Because the seed is God's word. The seed is God's word. But each ground is different. Each ground gives according to the capacity, capability. Normally, when a seed is extremely good, of great quality, so the seed multiplies 40 times more. But God's word has the capacity to multiply into 100, 60, or 30, depending on the ground, depending on where it falls. So you can see that inside of the church, we have different people, Christians and Christians, believers and believers. We have those that are evil. There is a great difference, a great, great difference between pastors and pastors, bishops and bishops, between assistants and assistants. There is a great difference in people that have been receiving the Word of God. And why? Why is this difference? Because it's the way they are receiving it. Jesus said that the way we measure, we shall be measured. You see that, you can confirm that in Genesis chapter 26, 12, when it says there that Isaac, he sowed in a foreign land, and he reaped 100 times more because God was with him. And the Bible says that, this is very interesting, that he became prosperous and was prospering and became very prosperous. And he had possessions of flocks and possessions of herds and great number of servants, so that the Philistines envied him. And why? Because he planted the seed in the right place. He sowed in the land, and the land received the best seed from him. We spoke about the seed. We spoke about the seed, the offering that Abel gave, and the offering that Cain gave. The offering, the seed that Cain gave, was not acceptable because it was not his best. But the seed that Abel planted, that Abel gave, the offering that Abel gave on the altar, that was multiplied. That brought him benefits. God, he was pleased and he was honored with the offering. So life is made of this. In the book of James says that we cannot mock God. God is not mocked. For everything that man sow, he will reap. I want to tell you and let you know that for 40 years, I have been sowing the Word of God. Actually, 50 years since the time I got converted, since Jesus brought me and made me born of His Spirit, I have been sowing the Word of God. And in the beginning, it was very, very difficult. But after some time, God was opening the doors, seeds was being springing up, and we were prospering and investing. And today, we are all over the world. And why? Why we are all over the world? Because there was a care. We were diligent. We made the sacrifice. We did what we needed to do. We gave the best of ourselves. So then, because of what we gave, we also received. So, my dear listener, your life, you pastor, you assistant, you bishop, you who are member of a church, you are an official of a church, your ministry, your life, your spiritual life, all your life depends on what you are putting on the altar. Because the altar is perfect. The altar is perfect. But the seed, if it's perfect, is going to be multiplied into 100. It is not going to be 30 or 60. It's going to be 100. But the problem is that the person, in the time of giving, they give one kind of seed that does not give fruit because it's not their all. So we see that if one, the seed is the same, the Word of God is the same, once it is obeyed, once it is placed in practice, when a person is diligent to follow and obey, as Jesus says, I know my sheep and they hear my voice and follow me. That's what he said. Isn't this nice? So, you don't believe in me, he told them, because you are not of my sheep, Jesus told these. He told this to the Pharisees and the hypocrites, the Jews. You don't believe in me, because you are not my sheep. You hear my voice, but you don't obey, because you are not my sheep. But the ones who hear my voice, meaning the ones who are of a good ground, so then these, they follow me. They follow me. So these that are following Jesus, can they fail? Can they be defeated? A sheep that follows God, can it be a failure? Or can be tormented by a spirit of depression? Can it be a person that is angry? Can it be a person that is driven by anxious or anxiety? Or a person that is unbalanced? Of course not. No, no way. Because when a person hears the Word of Jesus, the Word of God, they are following, they are obeying. And not only to hear with your ears and not practice, because there are people who don't understand. It's to hear and practice, to hear and obey, to hear and follow. My sheep hear my voice and follows me. They hear my voice and follow me. So, when each one of us, when we spoke about Isaac, he planted in a foreign land and became prosperous, billionaire, prosperous. Imagine now, my dear listener, when we sow the Word of God, when we sow it on the good ground, when we sow God's Word on the ground, we have the fruits. Now pay attention. Evaluate this. Imagine when the Word of God, when the seed of God, when the seed that comes from God's mouth, it's not from the angels, from God's mouth, It comes not from the angels, but from God's mouth. He himself, the creator of heaven and earth. Imagine when you put this seed, which is his word, inside of you, and you begin to obey, you begin to practice, you begin to dedicate yourself, and you prioritize, and you obey his word, his seed. How can it not your life move forward? How will your life not move forward? Your life needs to be a piece of heaven here on earth. I know you're going to have the difficulties, because problems you're always going to have. Because when Isaac became rich, because he obeyed God's word by sowing, he began to be envied by his enemies. And this will also take place. We are always going to end up coming across these enemies, the enemies that are the kings of this world. It is part of our life. A person who does not obey God's word, so they're going to reap a bad result, a rebellious result, and we are reaping the fruits of obedience. And of course, it confirms with God's word that says God's word cannot be mocked. Whatever a man reaps, so he shall reap. So your life is a reflection of what you have been sowing. Yes or no? But Bishop, so it means that all the curse that my life is in, I am responsible for that? Yes. Yes, you are responsible. You have been making your choices. But Bishop, I didn't have a father, mother to raise me. I was influenced by this world, by these people. I had no guide, by nobody. No, that's not a matter. You followed your intuition, your own desires. And you have not been listening to the voice of God. So you have been following what you well please. And you are reaping a bad result, God has no fault in this. What fault does God have if you made a bad choice? God has nothing to do with that. So we are the results of what we are sowing. And it's a matter of intelligence. It's a matter of not even of faith, but intelligence. If I choose to sow banana, I will not reap apples. If you sow apples, you are going to reap apples. If you sow rice, you shall get rice. What is good, you shall have what is good. So whatever you sow is what you're going to reap. And that's going to be the result. And this is the question. But Bishop, how can I resolve this then? Because all my life, I have been reaping what is not good. That's why my life is upside down. So what can I do? The first thing you need to do is you must repent from all your bad choices. Yes, you must repent from all the things that you did in the past and say, Lord, you know, I recognize that I have been reaping what is not good. But from today on, I want to sow what is left of me. I want to sow on the altar. I want to sow in your hands. I want to sow before you. And from today on, I want to determine to obey your voice, to obey your word. That's what I want. And if you exist and you see me and hear me, so then here is my life. Take my life. I surrender my life to you so that your altar may be fruitful in me and make a new life. And then you shall have day after day a transformation that will take place that you shall have. We are going to hear in a few minutes. We're going to hear a very beautiful song. But right after that, we are going to hear testimonies of people that had a life destroyed, and today they are happy. Thanks be to God.
feeling small. When tears are in your eyes, I will dry them all. I'm on your side. Oh, when times get rough on the street, when evening falls so hard, I will comfort you. I'll take your part, oh, when darkness comes.
Side of me towards my mom. So I felt rejected. I felt like she didn't love me. I just always felt like if I was alone. I had a little brother at that time, which I always felt like if I was his mom, I was always taking care of him. Just a lot of situations in the house that I don't feel that I shouldn't have had to been placed in. I was very rebellious. I started drinking at a very young age. Just trying to fill that emptiness. When I left my house at 16, I had met my kid's father. We ended up living together. He was a gang member, and it was a different kind of suffering. He was unfaithful to me. He was involved in selling drugs. He was murdered, and he died in my arms. That was the beginning of another suffering. Because of all of that, we ended up being homeless. So me and the kids ended up living in the car. I didn't want to live. I was thinking about committing suicide because I didn't know how to be a mother and a father. You know, my son caught me in the bathroom with the pills in my hand. That was, I think, the hardest, you know. And that is where I said, this is it. I felt the difference when I left that first Friday. I started seeing things falling into place. You know, of course things come and go, problems, but it's, you handle them in a different way. Where there was hopelessness before, there was hope. They teach you how to use your faith. They teach you how to put it into practice, how to see results, you know, and get those fruits, see those fruits from your faith. An intelligent faith. All the curses are turned into blessings.
A follower waits for bread and fish. A disciple is a fisherman. A follower fights for growth. A disciple fights to reproduce. A follower surrenders part of their goods. A disciple gives up all their life. A follower loves freedom. A disciple enjoys serving and sacrifice. A follower is worth because they add, a disciple because they multiply. A follower is conditioned by circumstances. A disciple uses it to exercise their faith. A follower is valuable. A disciple is indispensable. Universal Church of the Kingdom of God.
My life before I joined Universal Church was very empty. When my parents got divorced as I was a young child, that really affected me. I didn't know how to cope with that or to vent to anybody. Hold on. My mom would get in a lot of fights with my dad when I was a little girl. And I witnessed a lot of what would happen in the house. My mom would hit my dad. And my dad would sit in a chair and deny that he didn't do anything wrong when we knew what he was doing was wrong. He would cheat and spend the money that he shouldn't have been spending for the family. And I was really little. I don't remember how old. But that's what I remember. My dad coming home late and my mom pulling him aside and talking to him in the room and closing the door. But I would listen to everything through the wall. And I'd hear my mom crying and upset. My mom asked for a divorce, but my dad left the house and the house went under foreclosure and we had to move. My mom had to carry everything and she was so concerned about what was going on with her and my father that she didn't really give me the love that I needed to let me know that it was going to be okay. I just grew up with that resentment towards both of my parents and the confusion, and I didn't really know how to handle that. I had a best friend who I'd always hang out with. I would leave my house to go be with her to escape my problems at home. And that's when it all began, and I started using drugs with her and we became really close. And I hated being home because I knew at home I had to deal with what was actually going on. I would come home high and very aggressive and violent, and everything my mom said would upset me and irritate me. And there was no love or communication. So my mom and I would start to argue and then progressively we'd start to fight. My mom had anger issues too, so my mom would react in hitting me. So we had a lot of problems at home. The problems inside of me were building up. Well, I had a child at 17. living at home with my mom and things still aren't okay. I still haven't been able to express all this time what's been going on with me. And she kicked me and my daughter out. Grandma was the only person that was willing to take me and my daughter in and help me. So she suggested that I come stay with her. When I came down to Grandma, she took care of me like if I was her own daughter. And that's when she told me that I needed to go to church and that my life needed to change. I went on a Friday, so that's a great day to go. I was getting attacked and I didn't know it spiritually. My grandma's telling me it's gonna be okay to just relax and try to listen to the message. I continued to go to the Universal Church in Corona when the pastor took me aside and talked to me. He knew I had issues, but he took the time to ask me what's going on and to pray for me. I felt like I just gave everything to God, and that's when I slowly started to change. And I was able to leave everything there at the altar, at the cross. As I was speaking and telling him all my issues, I felt sad, really hurt inside because I wasn't able to open up to anybody. But with him, I felt comfortable and I trusted him. But towards the end, after prayer, I felt different, happy, like I let everything go and that I had peace again and that God was going to help me change things for my life. I started to change the way I lived my life and who I was and the things I chose. And I have some downtime being sober and clean, so I'm really proud of myself. I spend a lot of quality time with my kids. We work out all together, so we go to the park, we'll go to the movies, or we'll have lunch. My mom's my best friend now, and we get along great. We go to church together every day.
Shepherd so loving and kind. life now, I can say thanks be to God, especially in my finance. It's not 100% what I want it to be, but I've seen great changes. And I could say, you know, with my job, with my status, and my daughters, especially my last daughter that has graduated from university. And I wouldn't have dreamed, you know, it was a dream, but you know, the dream has came true, because I wouldn't believe that she would have really gone through university, graduated with first honors degree as well. And this was only by the power of God, before things was really, you know, upside down. I was frustrated. I didn't have, you know, any high volume of confidence, but I truly see God in my life and also in my family, because before we used to be really divided, we didn't understand each other. Now it's really changed. And even here, I'm very happy that we understand each other better and have a closer relationship. So this wasn't before. And is by coming and, you know, getting advice and putting things in practice. One of my sister wanted to go back home because she thought things wasn't gonna work out. And I usually encourage her. I usually said, you know, and pass positive energy to her. And through that, she was blessed. And, you know, now her life has been changing significantly. And I too, because if they're blessed, I am also blessed. So yes, it makes me more happy and more joyful to see their striving step by step. So my advice would be, yes, first build a relationship with God. Yeah, have communion with God and seek guidance from Him. Because when you're strong inside, you're able to fight your problems, and it doesn't matter how difficult or challenging it is. If there are purposes of faith that you can take part in, don't take part in it because you see others doing it. Take part in it because you believe by you taking part in this purpose, you want to see the power of God. Don't go and just do it because of due sake. Do it because you want an answer, because you want to glorify God with the answer.
Thank you. tried to find your place, but found disgrace. Illusions turn to stones, and tears appear to fall. There's still one thing left to do. It all depends on you. He can turn the old and make it new. It all depends on you. Take a look at what you're going through, but still he cares for you. Surrender all to him and you will see. Whoa, whoa. Yeah, yeah, yeah. It all depends on you. He can change your life and take you high. It all depends on you. He can bring the sun back to your sky, and still he'll care for you. All you have to do is trust your life in him.